Hi again, everybody. Well, today I have a teardown of another a laser rangefinder equipment, but this time it's not just a rangefinder. It doesn't just measure the distance between two objects. This one is capable of measuring the speed of the object it's pointing to, and usually this one is commonly known as a police LiDAR or a radar. It's used mostly by police to measure speed of the cars on the road and give you tickets and things like that. Well, it can also be used, according to the data sheet, in order to measure the distances up to 1,000 meters, and sometimes used in accident investigations or construction sites, and you know, for all other purposes. It doesn't mean that it's a single purpose device. So let's take a look at what we get in the box, and it's not new. It's been used, and it came from, I believe it was from Texas or somewhere like that. And I am not even sure it's functional, but we'll take a look what's in the box and find out. There we go. Came in the bag. A nice bag. It's definitely used, but has a tag on it called L4. There we go. It's charged and it seems to be even working. And it says zero error 01. Speed is not known. All right. Okay, let me take a closer look at this this model. Zoom in, see if the camera can focus. This model is called Ultra Light LTI 20-20, and here is the specifics of this model. It's a serial number, and it's manufactured in October 27, 1998. So now it's 2015. Plus 2 years, so this one is a 17-year-old a model of a LiDAR equipment. It's pretty old, and it has you can see this has a series of menu buttons. I was able to find a manual for this unit online for this model, and it appears to be that these ones are still sold. I believe there's some modifications, and so this one will be ultralight 100 LR, and if the specifications for this model still hold, so that according to their website, the company, this company is this one is manufactured in US, Englewood, Colorado, and according to the specification on their website, this one is capable of measuring distance up to 1,000 meters, and it has also, of course, since this is a LiDAR, it has a speed measuring capability. Well, I looked a little bit more online, and I found that this model was about from $300 to $3,800. So it's not extremely expensive, but there are cheaper models. I found models with similar characteristics that are capable of all modern equipment. I guess that capable of measuring distances up to 1,000 meters plus the speed, and the cost could be as low as $1,500. These ones were very popular. I found them being used. Well, again, just a simple search on Google returns that these units are used by police worldwide. I found references to it being used in UK, Thailand, China, anywhere. Just call it. It is still appear to be working, but the battery is probably not fully charged. It did came with battery, and it doesn't have an on-off switch. Basically, there's only one on-off switch, which is this trigger right here. It serves as everything. It uses batteries that are it's inside this handle. It's only two 1.5 volt batteries, class it's a C-type battery. And there are two goes in like that. The whole unit come apart rather nicely. There's the four screws in the front of the panel, of the display panel, and there are also four screws on the front of the panel, which has the optics, and after disconnecting a few cables, I can slide this one out. However, there's a little complication because the power is connected from the batteries. The cables are connected by a screw, which is only accessible through the bottom of this of the handle. So I had to improvise and make myself a longer screwdriver so that I can screw the power. Well, actually, I was wrong this time. It's even easier than that. This part comes out, and this is quick disconnect cable right here that I can actually. Yes, I can actually disconnect this from the power. Just like that. So here we go.
here's so that means that I can actually yes, so this is the power that power on a white cable. This is a power for the display board, which is this one. And these are the connectors to buttons and the left and the right, depends on how you look at it. And this is the connector to the board right here. So there you go. I've able to take it apart very easily, and which is very, very nicely made. And I kind of like how it's built. It's very well built. It's all made of machined. See, all the parts are machined aluminum. And here's the the LCD panel, the user interface board, or how you call it, the display controller board. And here's the Maxim serial interface chip, and here's the connector. It connects and it's nicely shielded, basically, with the ferrite core to prevent from noise. I don't think anything interesting in this LCD controller board, so I'm not going to take it apart anywhere further, because I don't see anything that's exciting about this one. So here we go. This is the main component of the ultralight LT100 LiDAR. So what I can see right away, there are two main components. Of course, one is there's two channels. One is the laser pulse channel, which is the sending side, and as the receiving side. And you can see, if let me turn it around. This one's connected. One is, I believe this one is, the laser diode a board that generates the laser pulse that is then bounced off the objects. And then this is the sensor board right here. And both require a high voltage bias supply. One is presumably for the laser diode. Another one is, let me guess right now, because I'm not quite sure yet, before I can take this one apart, is for avalanche photodiode, or a photodiode for the sensing board. And both of them are supplied by high voltage bias. Here's two cables. They both go into a power supply board right here, and this power supply board has looks to be pretty complex to me. Has lots of capacitors and inductors. You can see it right away. On one side, for the laser pulse generating a board right here, it's not important to have a low noise supply. However, the sensor board requires not only high voltage but also a low noise supply, because if there's any noise in the bias supply, that noise will impact the performance of the sensor. This power supply board connected to the main microprocessor board right here. It has two chips. I believe one is the memory and another one is microprocessor. To find out what these are, I need to actually take the labels off of these chips. And here is the Texas Instruments TLC 1543C, which is this is a 10-bit analog ADC made by Texas Instruments. This ribbon cable connects it to the power supply board. It's not only you can think why there are so many connections from the controller board to power supply. It's not only have to control the power supply and the voltage for the bias. It also probably has some sensing here that senses the current into from the avalanche photodiodes, and that's required to prevent it from damage and make sure that the sensor has the performance that's required from it. There, both of this sensor and the laser boards are connected with their own ribbon cables right here, also to the microcontroller board right there. And the optics here are much more serious than you can see in the Bushnell rangefinder previously. This one is there are two separate optic wells. This is the machine, the aluminum, I believe, or actually this one looked like a plastic. No, this is the aluminum or a magnesium, something pretty light. The unit is this piece is pretty heavy, so my hands already started shaking after holding it for some time. Also, there are these plastic tubes right here. They provide additional shielding against the light, and the whole unit itself is inside the aluminum enclosure, so there are no lights can penetrate. And besides the light, there's a rubber belt around it that seals it against the moisture and things like that, I believe. So these tubes prevent the light from leaking out from the laser well to the sensing part of this LiDAR. I make it focus. There is a pin headers here for a serial interface. So I think this board, this unit is very much hackable. I will try to probably I will have to make it into another video. I'll try to get programming devices and see if I can actually restore the read the content of this of the memory on this from this chip, and then see if I can if I can get any information out of this the serial interface. Here are the board inside. So this one is designed and manufactured. This one is the 1996 version of the, right here you can see And another one is a little bit later. The unit itself, as I mentioned before, is manufactured in 1998. Here's another interesting observation. After looking at the rangefinders, several different rangefinders made by different companies, and I believe it therefore designed by different people, most of them have a pretty long focal distance from the sensor, from the collimating lenses in front, which are these lenses right here, to the sensor and the laser diode. In this case, we have something like I'd say roughly 96 or maybe, yes, about 102 millimeters, but that's the distance from the front of the lens to the plane where the photodiode is located, and the same is true for the laser diode. Well, I believe this is because not because of the sensing part, but mostly because of the laser part, the laser board. And the reason why is that the laser diode, as a source of the light, it's not infinitely small source. So it has an emitting a surface which is not small. So if you look at it in a like well, if we look at it naked eye, it's pretty small, but let's see, if you're looking at it in the magnifying glass, then we'll see something like this. So here's the laser diode, for example, on the surface, and there's an anode, a cathode, and here's the light emitting surface right here. So if you look at it from the 90 degree angle, we'll see something like that. This is how the source, the laser source, will look like. Of course, it's greatly magnified, and we can also look at it as not as an infinitely small dot source, but more like an elliptic source like this. In order to make it back, translate it or make it into a round source, a spherical source like this, we can use two lenses. So for example, if we have this source like this, or let's say we take it, here's an the laser diode, which is elliptic source, then we can use two lenses like that, sort of like that, which are kind of non-linear, and then when we project this the source of elliptic form, it's kind of squishes the light into from the sides like this, using these two lenses, and then at the end we'll have something which looks more or less round. However, since this is still not going to be the ideally small source, then when we collimate this the source, let's say we have this laser diode right here and a collimating lens right here. So only the light from the very sensor, very center of the diode, of the laser, will be collimated into a straight beam. Everything besides this is going to have slightly different angle, and that's going to cause either it's going to be either spread out like that, or it's going to intersect at one point or another somewhere right here. So basically you you're counting for the middle, for the average. And the farther it is away from the collimating lens, the closer to the ideal source, which is the infinitely small dot. And that's why I think there's kind of like a golden medium that's been found for this range finding devices. It's around 100 millimeters. You can see that here is the Bushnell rangefinder, and you can see I put it next to the LiDAR, and you can see the focal distance is roughly the same, which is 100 millimeters. So if somebody knows a better explanation why this particular focal lens is used, please put it in the comments, and I will probably be interested to find out. Does it make sense to make it longer? Will I win anything? No, that's an interesting question. I do have to mention that both of these range meters have a roughly similar size of the lens, of the optics. You can see that it's kind of about sort of it's 40 millimeters in diameter, something like that. So I believe the focal distance could be explained by the fact that this found to be the optimum size for the lenses. This LiDAR has what look to be high quality lenses, and they're not coated. They don't have this kind of green fade in them. Kind of look like a bluish, I think. And these ones are look coated, kind of dark, more like has like an infrared filter on them. These ones don't look like they have a but maybe I just it's just a different kind of filter. It doesn't have to have certain color in it into it to filter infrared. If this is using an infrared laser as well as infrared infrared sensor, it should be quite beneficial to have a filter on the collimating lenses. Well, and this one is definitely the laser. This is a diode laser board. I can clearly see the laser behind this shielding ring right here with my remaining eye, and and I'd say, as I mentioned a little bit just now, it has a pretty large surface that's about a half millimeter long or so. Probably camera will not be able you will not be able to see any of that on the camera, because it's not going to focus down there. But I still want to play with this LiDAR, so I don't want to take this shielding ring off this yet. And the most interesting part for me would be, of course, is behind this shield. Again, I'm not going to take this shielding can off this board yet, although I will eventually, because that's where I'm curious to find out how this one is built, and that's where the most interesting stuff is in, is how the sharp pulse generation works here and things like that. So here we go. Here's the sensor board, and now I think I have an explanation why the lens in front doesn't have the infrared filter on it, because the filter is right here, and you can see this is the filter. This one looked to me as an infrared filter by the tint of it and everything else. And this one has a, I think it came with the photodiode itself, and the marking on this one is DFS-00958 3K124. /46 SP. So let me show you the sensor board. So here's the sensor board with a photodiode. And here is the window with an infrared filter. I think the marking that I just wrote down is just for the filter, because it seemed to be glued to this to the cylinder, this the copper or brass cylinder underneath on a silicone or something like that. So it's kind of, it's easily moving. So this one is not affixed to the photodiode, because if it was, it wouldn't be moving this easily. So I I believe this is just, this is just the filter, which is this the photodiode itself is a different a different component, so this separate component, which is has been soldered to the board and located behind this this shielding can. If you notice the label on this, this shielding can right here, it also refers to filter. It says filter 909. Well, I believe this is 909 means this is the wavelength of the this is the one, the filter, infrared filter I was showing to you, is a bandpass filter, and this is the wavelength of the in nanometers that this filter is, it will be passing through. Another interesting observation, again, I found that if you see that there are no alignment, special or any kind of alignment mechanisms, precision and precise alignment mechanism, besides the, you know, the screws pretty much will align it plus minus half millimeter, but there is nothing there. No, these ones are not glued after being aligned. Those are just screws. There are no silicone or epoxy or any kind of anything that would preserve the alignment of these boards to the body. And there is an explanation for that, because according to documentation that the user manual, you can see this aiming device, which is the red dot or virtual red dot aiming device, is that's how you calibrate this LiDAR, and there are specific instructions of how this aiming device can be aligned with the with this board, so that it points to the location that which you measure the speed. Obviously, by moving this board, I probably misaligned this one, but knowing the mechanism, I can probably align it if I find this completely out of alignment, or otherwise I'm going to play with it for now without it. All right, so I got it back together, and well, I have to tell you because I disassembled the sensor board. I removed the sensor board off the body. Of course, I misaligned everything, and then even using the alignment procedure that described in the manual, which involves using some of the Allen keys, the screws inside this base, didn't help me much. So I have to disassemble it back again, and then move the board, and then move the board again, so that I can get myself into some kind of soft spot where I can actually start using the alignment on this the aiming device right up top of here. The way it works, it gives you a feedback information. If you, for example, if I press the button here, it says TT test, and then at that point you need to find an object about 200 meters away, and you're using the pitch to find out the whether the red spot is pointing in the middle of the object that you're trying to measure distance to in this case. So I'm not sure if you can see the pitch signal is that's kind of the signal that's used in order to align the red dot aiming device on top of this LiDAR. And that's actually recommended to do before every a measurement. If the instrument was, especially if the instrument wasn't used for a lot of time, and basically temperature and other things such as vibration can make it out of alignment, so you'll have trouble measuring it. I'm not sure how big of an error it is. It could be. So aligning, since I actually moved the sensor board, so that alignment was a measure a trouble. I would say if you have one of those and you don't really have any reason to move the sensor board or and screw it from the base, you probably should avoid the trouble doing that. Looks like I found a standard tripod mount right here. So this range meter can easily be mounted on a tripod, which is very nice. I don't really need this shoulder aiming device, but there is a tripod mount. I think I'm gonna use this to fine tune my alignment. Just need to get outside somewhere and find the good open space where I can put some marks and do the alignment and calibration. I'm quite sure this LiDAR was not calibrated for quite some time. And okay, let's run some experiments. Here I have the LiDAR laying down on my table, and you can see the distance to the wall is about I'd say less than 2 meters, so 150-160 centimeters. So I'm going to position it roughly, approximately perpendicular to the wall, and this is a white, sort of a little bit grayish a wall, a painted drywall, and I'm going to switch it into a survey mode, which is the mode in which it measures the distance, the ranges. It's quite longer at this in this mode, but what I'm interested in this case, of course, is what are the shortest distance at this LiDAR is capable of measuring, and you see how reliable is going to be the distance that I can measure with the LiDAR towards this wall. So let me try the first time. 4.8. So every time I record this distance, I'm going to write it down. So 4.8, that's number one. 4.8, number two, 5.2. Okay, 5.2. You see, I didn't move the LiDAR. 4.8, 6, 5.0, 7, 4.8, 5.2. So here is the distance I have recorded over about 1, 2, 3, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 measurements, and the minimum is 4.7 and the maximum is 5.2 feet, which is in centimeters will be 143.25 centimeters, and the maximum is 158.49 centimeters. So the delta is about 15.24 centimeters, and that's exactly what the specs say for this particular model. It says the accuracy that it can provide in the distance measurements is about 15 centimeters or less. The maximum is 15 centimeters, and obviously my experiment wasn't exactly accurate. I could have moved the device few millimeters when I was measuring it, the distance to my wall. So it does comply with its specification, which is 15 centimeters. And I believe that the distance, the accuracy is not going to be different much with the distance, because it's mostly affected by the duration and the form of the pulse. So if we have let's say the laser pulse, and it's kind of look like this, so the accuracy with which we measure the distance greatly depends on the discriminator, which inside the sensor. It depends on how sharp is the laser pulse that it generates, and also characteristics of the sensor also play the role. Well, to see the form of the pulse, I have set up here another experiment where I have my own board. So let's take a look at that. So here is the setup that I'm going to use to make my next measurement. So what you see on top here, this is a power supply which provides the bias into an avalanche photodiode that's located inside this board. You can see this is the bias. Unfortunately, there were some noise problems, so I had to shield this one using the copper tape. And so this is nothing more than just a power supply it takes 5 volt input, and this is it's regulated, can be adjusted by providing the bias voltage from 0 to 1 volt, which is translated to a bias supply from 0 to 300 volts. And you can see if I I'm using the bias in this case, it's 24. I better use 20. Found that it works best with 240 milliamp, which is roughly equivalent to about 80 volts bias right here. And here is the plus minus 5 volt supply for the operational amplifier inside this sensor board. And here is the avalanche photodiode. You can see it's it points towards this a CD inside a white bag that I'm going to use as a target. And here is a small delay line. This is all together, and here is the small comparator that is this is Analog Devices 96667, something like that. This is the fast comparator. It generates, it will generate an ACL, MECL pulse, which is from minus 2 volts to ground. It's a negative logic. It's an old school. It's very old ECL logic. technology, but this one is very fast, a comparator, and it was very easy for me to use. It had the least amount of problems in terms of how to bias it and bypass capacitors and things like that. So I used that one. So let's take a shot. Trying to measure distance to this CD and see what we get on a scope. The output goes into a coaxial cable right here, and it goes into my oscilloscope that I've set up. So here we go, input goes into the fourth channel of oscilloscope. It's a red track here. You see here is the ground level, and it's biased at minus 2 volts. Basically, it's correctly terminated, and the terminated output is terminated at, with minus 2 volts at 50 ohm, and that's the correct one of the correct terminations for ECL logic. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to set a trigger on this channel. And okay, so there we go. And I'm going to take the LiDAR and point it to the CD. Okay, so there we go. We got a signal captured. I think, unfortunately, this is not a very good configuration. I probably should try again with see if I can get it with higher timing resolution. Okay, this is too much, but I think that's correct. That's pretty good. So this is pretty much consistent with what I had before. Let me zoom in on the screen. So this one is 13.1 nanosecond, and the rise time is 4.1 fall time at 3.8 nanoseconds. And obviously this is all affected by the boundaries of this scope, as well as my own board. So I think the pulse can be, in reality, could be much sharper. So this is not in any way indication of how sharp is the pulse that this LiDAR generates, because my measurements could be completely wrong. And the limitations are most likely is in my sensor board that I have created. But the duration of the pulse should be pretty much accurate, I think, regardless of how sharp is the pulse. The shape of it might look different in reality, but the duration is should be pretty much accurate. So it uses about 13 nanosecond pulses. In comparison, the Bushnell rangefinder uses has 20 millisecond pulses, which are much longer, and that's limits the minimum distance at which that can be measured with the Bushnell rangefinder. The signal used to measure speed look exactly the same. So the first signal, you can see the first pulse, it's exactly the same, 13 point something a pulse. And I wasn't able to capture all the pulses that used to measure the speed. I believe this LiDAR simply measures the distance several times with consecutive measurements, and then calculates an average speed by calculating the difference in the distance. However, I don't have the memory in this oscilloscope that's deep enough to capture all the pulses, and in fact I can only see one. So comparable to the 13 nanosecond resolution of this particular pulse, the pulse width itself, the distance, the interarrival time between pulses is much greater, and I believe that's about it either uses 100 or maybe at most 1,000 pulses per second, or maybe less. Another thing that I am not sure if this particular unit is equipped with anti-jamming capabilities, because this one is made in 1998, and I remember there were jammers on the market at that time. I live in Canada, in British Columbia, and as far as I know, people can use a LiDAR jammers in this province. So these ones are, so LiDAR jammers are sold, and they can be used by drivers provinces, and some provinces those are illegal, and so it's all different. Okay, so what I have done here, I changed the acquisition mode on my oscilloscope, and I started using a peak detect mode, obviously, duh. And so in this mode, well, you cannot see the shapes, but I can see the pulses. So what I'm doing here is I'm using the test or the calibration function of the LiDAR, and that's used in order to do the aiming or the red dot pointer adjustment, and makes this a signal. I think it sends more pulses, so it's used the frequency as a feedback. So let's see what we're gonna capture. Okay, so you can see here is the series of pulses. They evenly spaced. Cursor evenly spaced at looks like 10 milliseconds, yeah. So they spaced at 10 milliseconds, which is 100. Hertz. So let me use the same mode, see if I can capture the pulses. For the speed measurement mode, there we go. So I see clearly right now why I wasn't able to see the rest of the pulses for the speed measurement, because here goes the first pulse, arrives, let's say if we call this time zero, let me get a pen pointer. Say this is the time zero right here. The second pulse comes at 72 milliseconds later. And there seem to be series of pulses coming in a series like this. So let me, you can't see when if I zoom in like this, you can't see the discrepancy. However, this is what if I zoom out, it's like almost like the anti-aliasing effect right here, but I hope my camera can show it clearly, that there are gaps between the series. So if I let me see, if I zoom in like that, okay, and I use my cursor, so here is cursor, okay, x1, so this is so this is roughly 10 milliseconds. Okay, and if I go and I start moving this cursor, you can see 10 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds. See how accurate is that? 10, 10. 10, 10, 10. So I don't see any discrepancy in the pulse inter-arrival time of the pulse used to measure the speed. There is a slight difference here, maybe 1 millisecond, maybe less. I'm not sure if this is a systematic or if this is just a, this is just something that I see on a scope. No,
I don't see any discrepancies. This is it's always 10 milliseconds. No, always exactly 10 milliseconds. Okay. It is 10 milliseconds. Let's see if there are any other. Okay, and it's 73, 72, about 73 milliseconds till the arrival of the from the first pulse, which is used to measure the distance, I believe, till the series that's used to measure the speed. I'm going to repeat this experiment again and see if there are any variations in this timing. Okay. Well, and there we go. And it doesn't. Yes, I don't see any variations. So it's always first pulse and then 73, 72 milliseconds later, there are a series of pulses. I'm not quite sure if this is always the same number of pulses. And I might have been mistaken because I misread the manual. It probably has a jam. A detection, but it doesn't do anything to prevent the jamming. So if there are jamming device that's used against this LiDAR, it will detect the jamming by looking at the replies, but it might not be able to counteract it, the jamming, and show the speed in this case. It's just going to show a jam on the screen. So if you look at the test of LCD screen, you can see right here it has a jam. So obviously this model or the similar models, maybe it's a software or add-on option, but it does it has a jamming detection built into this another thing you can see, there's also kilometers per hour and mile per hour, mph kilometer per hour. This this display is capable of displaying metric measurements, but I don't know. I wasn't able to find any option to enable it, unfortunately. So that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. This was a teardown and review of Ultralight LTI 2020 LR100 LiDAR made by Englewood, Colorado Laser Technology Incorporated in 1998.
I'm sorry that I didn't do a review, a teardown of the sensor board inside this unit and the laser pulse board. Those are the boards that were covered by the shielding cap, and I'm afraid that if I actually try to unsolder it, I might actually damage the device, and I still want to play with it and perform some other experiments. Of course, I will, if I ever get to doing that, I will make a separate video and I make a high resolution photos of those boards. And I'm still interested in, I'm going to order the programmer, and I'm still interested in getting in reading the firmware on the microcontroller board, see if it's hackable or what I can find out. And what I really want to do is to change the fit to the freaking metric system. Anyway, if anyone know how to do that, please message me. I don't think, I think it looks like this LCD screen is hard-coded in feet, so I'm willing to take the change that will show me meters with F at the end. I just can't get the imperial system. It's just beyond my understanding why certain countries just can't switch to a metric system. I know that the latest models actually do have a support for a metric system, and they do show speed in kilometers per hour and distance in meters, and obviously they sell this LiDAR systems worldwide, so they have to, because the world is all metric, and Canada is metric too, by the way. All right. See you later. Bye.